To announce the first speaker of the day, which is Ignacio Luengo from the Universidad Complutense de Madrid. And the title of the talk is Motivic Integration and Iguza's Monodromy Conjecture.
Thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me to this event. I'm very happy to be here in this event in honor of Don César Camacho, whose mathematical work and style has influenced many of us, including myself. So I will start, but first let me just take a minute to make some propaganda. So if you can switch. As you know, I'm from Madrid, and the next World Congress of Mathematics will be in Madrid. So we have to make some propaganda, so it will be in 2006. So you can think about that and make some space in your agenda. I hope that it will be a great Congress. So let's start. See, there is a web page, but of course it's too early to think about that, but all you know. So this is the title. You see, has nothing to do with the title of this conference, but you will see this is about a problem in arithmetic, this Iguza monodromy conjecture, but what will deal with this problem using method of singularities. So you will see that here we will use a resolution of singularities, Puce expansion, toric maps, like for instance Felipe did the other day. In some sense is also in the scope of this conference, as César explained the other day, he was also very interested in singularities. So this is about the problem, and about the other part, motivic integration. Well, you should not be afraid about motifs. There will be very elementary motifs. In fact, this motivic integration is a theory that has to do also with singularities. This is was invented by Concevic, and it's essentially integration in space of arcs. So that's also very much to do with singularities. It's the work of Nash, as Aroka explained the other day. But so essentially, it's integration in the space of arcs. But you know, the inventor chose the word motivic integration because it's more appealing. So that's something that happens very often in mathematics. No? So for example, many of you know the comments of René Thon about the theory catastrophe. They say that if one invent one theory, then one new theory, one important point is to choose the right word. And that was the case of theory of catastrophes as well, but that's the word that use Concevic. Okay, so this is more or less the plan of the talk. So we'll talk about first that this arithmetic problem is the monodromy conjecture for Iguza zeta function. We will see that this is the first part. We will see that this problem can be expressed in a like a problem purely in singularity theory. That's the topological zeta function. And then we explain the main tool for this is the motivic integration. That we will see explain what is this, how it's come by studying the space of arcs in a variety. Then we'll translate the problem in terms of motivic integration. That's this motivic zeta function, and then we will give the result that we have obtained for the in order to prove this this conjecture. So I have to say also that all the our work is in common with the people in the title, Artal, Casulgues, Imelle. So before I forget, let me just show you the references. So this is the most or less the list of references. The first is a report of Deneff in Seminar Rubaki 12 years ago about this problem and Iguza zeta function. Then there is a recent work of Lenef Roser about the germs of archaeans in global varieties in the corresponding notific set of function. And next one is Igusa is the original, one of the original paper about this problem. And these are, the other is the one of the main reference for quasi-ordinary singularities. And this is this base is a work related with that, and also the last one. And this the recent work that I will talk about is in a preprint in the archive preprint server. So let's start with the problem about this arithmetic problem. Is I will explain it in a most elementary way. Just take one polynomial in n variables with coefficient in Z. Then one is interested in to count the number of solution of this congruence f of x congruent to zero both pk in Z to over pk to the d. This is the number of variable. Then, as usual in this case, one can take this number and consider the corresponding putting a generating series. For the usually this call Poincaré series. And in fact, in this case, this series was considered by Hilbert himself. So, what has that? One of the first questions is to know if this series is rational. That remember that this gives some kind of recurrence formula. That means that all these numbers are determined by a finite number of these values nk. So that was asked by Safarovich Obarevich if this generating series for the number of solution is rational, and it was proved that the answer is yes. In fact, he proved that proved that this function, it's called the Igusa zeta function of S, is rational in p to the power minus s. That means that this p of t is rational. And was one essentially using the solution of singularities. I would say the proof is based in periodic integration. One consider this integral. So this Igusa zeta function can be put as an integral of the type f or the function f to the power s. So this is a very typical problem that study this function. So in this case, we take this integral, taking the hard measure normalizes, so that the measure of the integrals is 1. But the most important part is this exponent of f in the integral. As I say, the proof is the solution of singularities, and in fact, in the proof, for instance, obtain the most important thing is information about the poles, and the poles are of this form. Well, Ni and Nui come from the embedded resolution. I will put it in a moment what the meaning of this. Then the main problem is that we are considering is the so-called monomial conjecture. So this is the subject. So the monomial says the next take a pole of this Igusa zeta function that in some sense govern the asymptotics of the number of solution, and then the exponential of 2pi, the real part of this pole, is an eigenvalue of the complex monodromy of the function, the complex monodromy of, let's say, around one singular, in the minimal fiber, around one singular point of the function. I will recall now the definition. So this is, there is also a stronger version, just asking also that the exponential of the poles are also roots of the Westing polynomial. But what comes this conjectures. How is that? The main motivation was that the calculation that IGUSA did were in the Archimedean case, error C, and give this this result. In fact, this conjecture is proved in the Archimedean case by Malgrange. But this is a very very interesting and mysterious question. So you have, well, it's like in the Fantin's theorem. You have one arithmetic information that's something related with the asymptotic number of solution, and on the other hand you have a topological information. That's the hidden values of the monodromy acting in the minimal fiber. So what is the relation between those two things? So it's is really very mysterious. But the answer is not known yet in general. As you can see, immediately one relation into both things is just for this. I need some standard definition. So we consider resolution of singularities of this hypersurface. So we will take the resolution of singularities of the hypersurface. As usual, we call the the sessional divisor in call it the union of EI, and for each subset of the index J, we consider the intersection of the divisors. We call it EJ, and also the interior part of the intersections. So that's we call EJ one. So that's this intersection minus the other divisor. So we have this, and then we attach to this intersection of divisor. We have two number. One is the order of the function, and as usually we call it this here Ni, and the other is one plus the order of the pullback of the number is the differential. That means this is the order of the Jacobian U1. So we have two numbers, Ni and Ui, the order of the function, pullback of the function, and the order one plus the order of the Jacobian of P. And then from this one can have a closed formula for the monodromy. So remember, the monodromy is obtained, you want to take the usual mean of fibration, and then we call H the geometric monodromy, and H star on the mean of fiber, around one point that we take, for instance, the zero. We take the algebraic monodromy acting in the homology, and we take the zeta function of the monodromy. That means alternate product of the characteristic polynomial of the monodromy acting in each group HQ. Then there is a formula for this is the Campo formula that gives this zeta function of the monodromy in function of the in function of the this data of the resolution. So this is the zeta function of the monodromy can be expressed at the 1 minus t to the ni, the only characteristic of the ni. Here, so this is the only appear the order of the function, and here is only taken when we have one index, we are considering the co-dimension one part. So intersection of only one divisor. Okay, so this is the formula for the zeta function of the monodromy, and then there is also a formula for the IGUSA zeta function that is was proved by let me see if I found I found it. Maybe it's in the other side? Okay, yes. No, no. not yet. It will come. So here it is. Okay? So, you see, one explicit formula for the function of the resolution for the Gusev zeta function. Here, this is the number of points the number of rational points over P of this intersectional divisor, and well, this is the formula. But here, there is a difference that they appear the nj and also the new j, the order of the Jacobian, and also here this sum is over all the subset of index. That means that over all the intersection of multiplicities. Okay, but there is a first relation between one or the other. In fact, well, let me also say that, in fact, here one can now put this in a problem of essentially only of singularities. For this, one has to, in this formula, well, if we have a look at how it's proved, then we can see that essentially the only thing that it uses is that this function, number of points, is an additive function in the class of algebraic varieties. So there is a very few additive functions in the class of isomorphic class of algebraic varieties, but they are very useful. One of these is this number of points. There is other like odd Hodge polynomial, and there is also other additive function is the Euler characteristic. So here everything can be put in terms of this function. In fact, here this is exactly the number of points of the affine line over FP. So one can obtain the same formula applying to a resolution instead of taking number of rational points, taking the Euler characteristic. The only problem is that if you take the Euler characteristic, of course, here they will be they will give zero and zero. So if one applies some kind of limit or L'Hopital rules, one obtains some formula it depends only on the Euler characteristic. So this is the term topological zeta function. As I say, so this is taking the limit when p tends to 1 of the Gusev zeta function, one obtains this expression. So, in fact, this is an invariant, interesting invariant of the singularities. And, in fact, for the point of view of singularities, the main point is to prove that this is invariant. You can get, for any embedded resolution of f, you get this data, ai and a number nu I, g, n I, and you can put this formula. Then the proof directly that this is an invariant independent of the resolution is very difficult. In fact, to my knowledge, no one has done. So the way to prove it is just proving that this is the limit of when p tends to 1. And that was done by René Filoser. So but. You see, it's a special situation. You have something analytic or topological, and to prove the invariant, you have to use periodic integration. But, in fact, you will see that later that the invariance of this function can also be proved using periodic integration. Then the poles of the function are almost the same as the original Gusev zeta function, and in fact one has a topological version of this monomial conjecture. So you have the same conjecture in this case. So that if you take one pole, in this case the poles you see are of the form minus nu over n, so they are rational in the case of this topological zeta function. And then the monodromous conjecture say that if you have one of these poles, then the exponential is an eigenvalue of the complex monodromy. So it's also an interesting problem. It's some kind of test problem for the order arithmetic problem. In fact, the main question, as I said, everything is come from the resolution, but the main problem is that the resolution gives gives a lot of candidate polls, a lot of expression of this form, but the miracle, as you make example, is that most of them disappear. So really, this is you see, maybe you make a resolution of some embedded resolution of some polynomial, for instance, three variables. This is not easy, or sometimes it takes a lot of time, but you make up the computation with end up with maybe many terms, and then most of the, when you simplify the rational function, most of the terms in the denominator disappear. So that's something that say that there is some result behind. And in fact, at the beginning was thought that this due to the monomial conjecture, but you will see that well, this is not the case. So it's very related with the monomial conjecture, but this is not the case. Okay, so let me just mention result about the monomial conjecture in the result. Conjecture is true for curves. In the case of the Igusa arithmetic case, also in the topological case, that was proved by Igusa, Meusser, Loser, and also there is a proof based using log canonical models. In this case, you have the embedded resolution of one curve, and it is possible to determine the which are the divisor who gives the poles. In fact, they are called the rupture divisor. So you have the embedded resolution. Well, so these are the divisor, rupture divisor, are the one who has only characteristic different from zero, so then in which there is pass one of the component of the curve. Okay, so that's in this case one can understand very well where come the poles, but if you go for surface, then this is almost impossible. In fact, there is only two cases in the using the resolution. There are only two cases in which there has been proved the conjecture. One is the cone over a projective plane curve, and the other is super isolated singularities. That these are singularities whose embedded resolution is very much related with the embedded resolution of the cone over the cone over a curve. So, but this is the only case in which one has. It's possible to prove the conjecture using the solution singularities. In fact, we will see in the second part that to prove that one has to use a different technique, because this goes nowhere. So, for instance, Bayes has passed something like the 10 years trying to prove something in the surface, doing many examples, but you see the result are being really very small. Okay, so now we come to the technique of multimedia integration. And you see, multimedia integration comes in this story in this way. You have, as I say, that if you have any additive invariant in the class of of varieties, you can do define this invariant for the resolution. And in fact, what the multimedia integration is to take some kind of universal additive invariant. So they also call universal Euler characteristic. And what is the universal additive invariant? It's just, this is the second part of the slides. Just take the random brick, take fix a field K, they consider the varieties over K. And then consider K0 is the Grothendieck ring or semi-ring of K varieties. That's generated for the isomorphic class of varieties, and in this case, The addition is defined in this way. You have a closed set subvariety, then the class of x is just the class of x minus y plus the class of y. So this has gives you the addition in this getting the ring, and then the product is just taking the class the product of the classes is the classes of the class of the product. So this is so this gives some kind of universal additive function. So any additive function in this ring just factorized through this so this function. And this is the only motif that we will use. They are called Lesser motifs. They are something very simple. They are of course motifs more complicated or mysterious, but this one is very easy. So we are just for us the motifs is. Just the classes of this quasi-projective variety. One can take quasi-projective varieties, and because of this, well, the main property that we use is that you can define the class of any quasi-projective varieties. In fact, in any constructible set, I mean, this using this property, you have the class of a constructive set. It's a union of locally closed set. And the other property that we use is that you have a let's say, an algebra free variation, then the class of the class of the total space is the product of the classes. So we will use that, especially when the fiber is just some affine space. Okay, and then this is the space where the multiplication integration take value. So we have now consider the space of arcs, and we can define some measure in the space of arcs or some set subset of the space of arcs, and the values of the measure are just taken in this ring or solar localization of the rings. And that this is what is called motivic integration. You said it was invented by Concevitz. And in fact, this was an analog of the periodic measure in a periodic variety. And there was this way Concevitz obtained a very well-known result. A very strong result that the Calabi, Birasian equivalent Calabi-Yau manifold has equal Hodge number, in particular equal Betti numbers. In fact, this was proved first this result for the Betti number by Batiret using periodic integration. And then, the big idea of Concevitz was substitute periodic integration by motivic integration, using integration in the space of arcs. So it was more natural because this is a result about complex manifold. So why one has to go to the periodic to prove something about complex, no? And then what Concevitz did was substitute periodic integration by motivic integration. So, let remain or just record you what is the space of arc. First, some notation. We'll see that in fact we'll take L. It will be the class of the affine line. It will be more or less the almost the only motif that will appear here, at least in the variety coming from the resolution of singularities, and then. And then for a non-singular, non-singular variety, let's say in characteristic zero, one can define the space of arcs. So formal arcs. Okay. So there's just morphisms of from K of T for to X. So there's a formal arcs. Then the arcs, of course, has a well-defined circle center, and one can make this is an finite space, and one can make give this let's say a structure of algebraic variety, pro-algebraic variety, a limit of a projective limit of algebraic variety. This is using truncation, truncated arc. So we consider truncated arc that will be son arcs truncated at order t plus 1, and this is naturally a finite dimensional algebra variety, and this Ln of x form a projective system, and this gives to Lx a structure of pro-algebraic variety. In fact, this was more or less introduced this space of hardware that was studied by Nash. So you Roca mentioned the Nash conjecture, and in fact that was the main point of interest of Nash. He used that in relation with resolution singularities. So he was interested in to spot some essential divisor in resolution singularities. This is a small but important difference. Nash, in fact, was interested not in this bus, but in the projection of Lx that is always contained here. But this is more difficult. So these are the truncated arcs that leaf that come from a real arc, so that the leaves to a real arc, so an arc, and this is more subtle. So that's why working with this is more difficult. And this is one of the clever ideas of Concevi. So consider this space as a main point of interest instead of this one. So this just to spot what are the arcs who come from a real, truncated arc coming from a real arc. This is a difficult problem. Okay, then one, come the definition one. One can take what is the measure? So one take any semi-algebraic subset of Lx. That will be, roughly speaking, a semi-algebraic set will be a set in a, this infinite space given by a finite number of equations and inequalities. That this is a semi-algebraic set. And then one has to give the measure of this arc, this subset. Then for this, one consider for that, the measurable set will be the stable set. So the one who are the image of one of these constructible set AN in the space LN of X. So that's somehow this the measurable set will be so this semi-algebraic set in LX that are saturated for this. That means that this is the product of something finite by the something infinite in the next number of variables. So this is, in some sense, similar to a singularity theory. So you have some, you have finite determinations, so you have an infinite space, you can take a finite transversal, and you work in a finite case for the singularities, taking something that is infinite and free in the next variable. So this is the same thing. So the measurable set will be something like the cylinders in some constructible set in some AN. And in fact, this is the measure. And this term is just put here because to make the measure independent of the set that you project. As you say, you project your measurable set in different LN, then you get different set, but from one to the other there is an algebraic fibration. That means that reflects the fact that the equation are free in some variables. So this algebraic fibration has fibers, a fine space, and then that means that as in the rotating ring, one has this relation between one of the others. So in this way, this is gives something that is independent of the N. And then one talks about modulic integration. What kind of function what is integrate? In fact, the function that one integrates, for instance, a function from let's say from the space of arcs to so the function that one integrates, and in general, function from the space of arcs to let's say Z. That means a measurable function will be this kind of function. And for instance, which kind of, in the case of the proof of Concevit, what was used is taking a divisor D, and then the function is taking is given that taking for one arc, one gamma, one associates the order of gamma, the order of T of gamma. So this is the kind of function that we want to integrate. And for instance, other function that we will consider for us is just taking one hypersurface, one sum function, and then one associate to this function the order just the order of composition with phi. And then this set will be measurable, and then the set that we are interested. In fact, as this is because of we are taking this function with values in set, usually instead of consider the as usual the integral like that, we will be more instead of putting that to and compute all the measure of the different set, we will be more interested in the corresponding generating series. So this will be mu, the measure of the minus one of n t to the n, some kind of. So we will really use all the full power of integration. We have a change of variable formula, etc. But we will be more interested in, we'll put the function in this way, because we are interested in especially in this kind of generating series, especially in the case that they are rational. So, but we are really using all the result of let's say, motivic integration. But we, as we integrate this function, then we come to this motivic set of function. As I say, we consider the set where the value of this function mu is n, and we consider the corresponding generated series, and well, we have to adjust this for some term in order to make it invariant of the boiling up, and this is the motivic set of functions. I will see that in a moment that this is a version of this motivic version of the all Igusa set of functions. In fact, there is the NFLOSR give a proof that using the solution simulated that we have a formula for the motivic set of functions. In terms of the embedded resolution. And then you remember there was more or less the same formula that appeared in the for the Igusa set of function, but we substitute the number of points by the class for the lesser motif. So you can compare with the other two functions and you see that essentially just one substitute the class of EJ by the number of points and L by P that remember is the number of points of L of so you have for any additive function one get a specializing one get a set of functions. So for instance this has been used also with other important additive invariant like Hodge polynomials. Okay, and then, well, you can see here that the main point is that you can obtain this this function from this one. So, how do you do that? You have to substitute. Let's see, T by L minus S. You substitute T by L minus S, you will apply the additive function, number of points of this one, on the characteristic you get the other function. So that's the main, this is explained in the next slide. So, as I say, the main point is this function is rational, has been proved by Denel-Alosser, and then for you have this formula, As you say, for instance, the topological zeta function is obtained and applied in the only characteristic function to the this zeta function in which one substitute t by l minus s. And the same is the for almost all prime, if you apply the number of points to this motif zeta function, you get the Wieser zeta function. Okay? And in fact, one can give also the same monodomy conjecture for the motif zeta function. The only thing is that in this case, one has to just work a little, to make clear what means a pole of this function with of this series with coefficient in the ring, the localized ring. In fact, this is the ring of algebra of varieties. It's a complicated ring. It has the zero divisor. But in any case, doing some algebra work, one can determine what means a pole. In fact, the denominators are of this sort, and one can make sense to say that the from this denominator the pole is just as usual minus mu I over n I. But so one has that. One has, as I say, the monodromy conjecture. As I say, it's not the same. You have a pole, then the exponential 2pi of the real part is an eigenvalue of the complete monodomy acting in the minimal fiber of one singular point. And in fact, as I say, the formula given the other that related both in the use of zeta function and the motif zeta function gives the fact that this conjecture implies the corresponding conjecture for the arithmetic case and for the topological case. And the main result we have new is that we have proved that the monodomy conjecture is true for quasi-ordinary polynomials in arbitrary dimension. So just I will just in the remaining say what means by quasi-ordinary polynomials, but let me comment then that, in fact, well, we see also in the proof that we see essentially that in order to prove the this conjecture, one has to pass to the motivic case. I mean, this is it's essential. So it's there is an essential difficulty of why it cannot be proved in the periodic case. In fact, this is you see is a typical situation appears many times in mathematics. You have some difficult problems, and then you put it in a more abstract sense. I mean, adding some after more sense, and then the problem becomes easier. So this is the case of something that is almost impossible in the periodic case. Putting in the motivic, then at least becomes feasible. So let me then the remaining 10 minutes. Yes, I'm going for that. Okay. Okay. So quasi-ordinary polynomial is a polynomial such that just spot here one special polynomial or a series, one special variable set. So this is a polynomial such that the discriminant is a norm Markovsky. That means that the discriminant is a monomial times one. I mean, in good coordinates, the discriminant is a monomial times one unity. Okay, this is a polynomial that's very important. Has played a very important role in the June method of June Walker method of resolution of singularities of surface. So the first resolution of singularities. What was done in the 30s using this polynomial. Well, what is the idea? You take one surface, you take one special projection, consider the discriminant. So you have here the discriminant, and then you take an embedded resolution of the discriminant. Okay. And then here you consider the fiber product. You have some surface here, and you have a projection. And over this projection, of course, the discriminant is given by is given by the pullback of the discriminant. So this is a normal crossing. That means that all the singularities about these points are quasi-ordinary. And then from here one can resolve. For instance, taking normalization of that will resolve all the point, but this one and this one also can be normalized using Jung method. That was studied by Jung. So this gives really the first resolution similarities for varieties of dimension greater than one. So this is. And in fact, this questionnaire polynomial has been extensively studied by Zariski, Lindman, Gao, Gonzalez, Nemeti. Well, I put my name also in the list because my work in the subject has to do also with the resolution of the problem we are talking about. The main point is that from many point of view, quasi-ordinary polynomials behave varieties behave like curves. They have characteristic exponent. The topology is determined by the characteristic exponent. Well, other properties that we will see in a moment. This is the main point. Of course, in some other point of view, they are more difficult. For instance, the fact that the embedded resolution is determined by the characteristic exponent has been proved very recently, 4 or 5 years ago. There is one proved by Gonzalez, Perez, another proved by Orlando Villamayor. So that means that they are similar, but in some sense also they are more difficult. So. But one has also embedded resolution. But as I say, for this problem, embedded resolution, there is no help at all. Because it's so complicated that you will not get any geometric idea where the actual powers of the multiple theta function will be in the embedded resolution. So this is just hopeless. For us, the main point also in the, is that, that we call Jung-Avianca theorem is that this quasi-ordinary singularities of polynomials has roots, like in the case of one variable, that has series with rational bounded rational exponent in x1 xn. So one has one expression like in the case of curves, like that. Okay. And then one has also characteristic exponent. So I'm going too fast with the slides. So one can define then characteristic exponent. So if we have this root I put here. If you have this root, then one can consider the difference, the discriminant, this is a monomial, and as this is the difference of the product of the difference of the roots, then that means that the difference of two roots are aware of this way. There is a monomial times a unity. And this monomial, as in the case of curve, I'll call the characteristic exponent, or pure exponents, or whatever. So it has this set of characteristic exponent. In this case, the main point is that if the surface is analytically reducible, the variety, this is in any dimension, is analytically reducible, the characteristic exponents are ordered in the whole order, really in the total order. So that means that for each characteristic exponent, all the coordinates of the one are greater than or equal to the previous, etc. Okay, and the main point then also is that from this, one can see that the Newton polygon is of a special shape. So we consider now one has the set of characteristic exponents, we call it lambda CA, and then one consider the Newton polygon of F, that's we call it P of N. Then this is a we call this contrary to Felipe Cano call a Newton polygon only the compact faces. So we take the compact faces of the we call the of the convex hull of the support of the function, and this is the this is what we call the Newton polygon. And the main point is that then the there is a system of coordinates so that the Newton polygon is a monotonal path. What means that is that the Newton polygon is just determined by a finite number of points, of segments. So in the compact faces of the Newton polygon, there are only segments. So let me just, because this is important, tell me the next thing that you have. The Newton polygons, you have this only, and the fact that this is monotonal path means that, so you have only one dimensional faces, this is for any number of variables, and that means that monotonal path means that you take the projection of this point, and then the projection of the next point, and the next point, all are completely ordered. So this is in the canon of the next one, etc. Okay, so this is the main point. And then, just in order to compute the computer, now the motif zeta function, one has to take, remember, the order in T, the order in T of F of gamma of T. And then one can put gamma, gamma of the form of gamma of T, in the form T alpha 1 plus T alpha 2, etc. And one consider one can take use the hypothesis that all these are different from zero, the arc that we want to measure, because if one of them is zero, then the measure will be zero. So we have to consider all the arcs of this, and you see now it became something of another topic geometry. You have to take this and see in which point they give the minimal order, so you have to consider the dual determinant of the A1 AM, take the dual variety, and so in that way you start to count the order, and then you start to measure the set. So this is the beginning of the history, but this is the main property that we can use to compute this modular set of function. And the next important thing is that we call Newton mappings. You see, associated to any of these sides, any of this segment L, we can use one of these Newton mappings. You see, it is just the one who use in the Newton process, who appear in the Newton process of the computing the roots of the polynomial. So the only thing, usually in Newton later you have this, we have put set equal to set 1 plus alpha, and we put here y1 beta 1 over you have to call it p1. Bn over Pn. So this is the way one start to compute the Newton branches or the Newton roots. The only thing is that we don't want the denominators, just you use the usual trick of x. Okay? Usual trick, call it xy to the 1 over pi, you call it y. Okay? So you have that. That means that x to the pi is. So this is the usual Newton maps that appear in the Newton Poisson method, and you will see that this map, the essentially what it did is just put this segment in the horizontal, in the vertical. Sorry. So this segment will be here. The other will go somewhere, And so after one Newton map, you get something like that. And then you make this, so this is the toric part, and then you make the change of translation of the origin, and then you get, well, you get another polynomial, and the main point is this, this is again, because the map is toric, this is again, the discriminant is again a normal closing. So this, after one Newton map, you get a new quasi-ordinary singularities if you have seen the Newton method. Passing from here to here, you lose one characteristic exponent. So that's the main point. So the proof is just made using induction in the number of exponent. And well, and this is the main idea how I prove it. Of course, the dials are complicated. One has, in fact, it took us. This is the idea. It took us 1 year to carry out this idea and all the details. I mean, one has to make a complicated induction because the main point is with this you can lift arcs from below to above, but the lifting is complicated, and you have to change your setting. And you work first in C of seed X. Here you can say, but then you have to also consider polynomials in T in the coefficient. You have to make induction on the number of polynomials. But well, this is the main point, and. Okay, so I say that the main result is just proving that, and in fact, one obtains some additional information. So, for instance, for this method, one get the real poles. So the poles appear in this transformation, this will be the real part. So in the generic case, the formula, the closed formula one obtained from this Newton series of Newton maps gives exactly the poles. So that's why that's the reason why this cannot be in general obtained by just resolution of singularities. That because in this case there is no way to relate these poles. In fact, there is no way to relate it in the resolution singularities. You can see here why, because this map is not the Newton map I wrote here is not birational. So this has some ramification. That means it has some degree. So this is the map from the geometric point of view. The map passing from here to here is not birational. So by this reason, there is no way to change the poles going to the from the resolution of this to the resolution of this. And that's also the reason why just motivic integration is essential. Because I said you cannot follow the geometry of the situation, but you can follow the arcs. And also, from the situation from this map, you cannot also follow the periodic solution. That's why you cannot prove that using the method of the periodic case. So really, one has to work in the motivic setting. Otherwise, you cannot do that. Okay. And as I say, this method gives a very effective method to compute the poles in the general case of surface. But we hope that with this we'll get the conjecture for surface. In fact, the poles you can do that, and the poles are the coming as in the case of cars, the one coming from this the singularities above the quasi-ordinary singularities above the component of rot. So you can see from this, you can get a very short list of poems that usually are poems that they don't disappear for any for the general case of surface. Because proving the conjecture that that means these poems give also come from the eigenvalue of the monomy is not complicated, because in this case they can disappear, but well, we are working on it. And I think this is all. Thank you very much.